So I'm now pleased to introduce our next panel, Leadership from Military Service to the Private Sector, be moderated by Mr. Barry Steelman. Mr. Steelman is a retired trial attorney, but he is a former roommate of the founder of the American Veterans Center, World War II Society, Mr. Jim Roberts. Mr. Steelman served two tours on the USS Henderson in Vietnam. He has, just as the title of the program of the section states, he has made that transition from military service to private sector. We welcome Mr. Steelman.
Thank you, Craig.
I'd like to welcome all of you here today. I tell you, you're in for a great treat with this esteemed panel. The focus of the panel, as Craig said, is going to be transitioning from military to private sector and how leadership plays a role in that. Though most of you are far from transitioning from the military to a civilian job, everything you learn today will be very helpful in your future. 50 years ago, I sat where you are all sitting now as a first-class midshipman at the United States Naval Academy. I was completing my undergraduate studies. I was doing my military training, and I was excited and anxious about becoming an officer in the fleet. Soon, you will each embark upon your careers as officers in the Army, Navy, Air Force, Coast Guard, and Merchant Marine. We're so honored to have all the services represented each year. You will take with you your education, your military training, and your experiences to the first duty station you are honored to get. The panel will advise you on various aspects of your military years that will help you when that time comes in your future to transition. Before I introduce the panel, I want to give you the advice and tell you what my father passed on to me as I was getting ready to graduate the academy. He said, "Son, realize you don't really know that much about going into the fleet. Walk up to the most senior enlisted person in the division you will be leading and tell him you realize you don't know that much and that you're here to listen to him or her and you'll do what you need to do to become that good officer." And I tell each of you, that was great advice. It stands today as well. Now I'd like to introduce the panel. Starting from the, I'm going to go in a different order than they're sitting, but Lieutenant Colonel Paul Cowley, after graduating Ohio University in 1979, he completed his OCS training and went straight into the Marine Corps. He selected to become a fighter pilot, and after he obtained his wings in 1972, he flew OV-10 Broncos. One of his assignments was at Andrews, where he was the operations officer and second in command of the MAG detachment. After 7 years of active duty, he moved to Atlanta and joined the reserves, retiring as a lieutenant colonel, serving a total of 23 years as a Marine pilot, both on active duty and in the reserves. Immediately after joining the reserves, he became a pilot, as he's wearing his captain's uniform as he speaks today, with American Airlines. He has flown for American for 32 years. He is currently a captain and serves as a mediator for the Allied Pilots Union, attempting to resolve disputes between pilots. Next, sitting next to him, is Lieutenant Colonel John Flynn. He is an Air Force Academy graduate and a former director of operations, a wing executive officer, and a flight commander with the 60th Air Mobility Wing. During his 16 years on active duty, he flew C-17s, including combat missions in Iraq and Afghanistan. His final position in the Air Force was as senior military advisor, or aide, to Vice President Joe Biden. His first two post-transitioning jobs as we're talking about today, were as advisor to Vice President Biden and then as special assistant to President Obama. After leaving the White House in 2016, he joined MGM Resorts International as executive director and initiative strategies. He was recently promoted to the position of vice president and chief of staff to the chairman and CEO of MGM Resorts International. He remains active in the Air Force Reserves. He flew in a red eye this morning from Las Vegas and is flying out tonight after the reception. Next, Dr. Jack Philip London. He's a graduate of the United States Naval Academy, class of 1959. Also, he's a graduate of the Naval Postgraduate School, where he earned a master's degree in operations research. He further holds a doctorate degree in business administrations from the George Washington University. During his 12 years on active duty as a regular officer from 1959 to 1971, which was during the Cold War, Dr. London initially served as a naval aviator and carrier pilot, serving with the U.S. Navy hunter-killer task forces against the Soviet Union's strategic nuclear submarine threat. Dr. London left active duty in 1971 and joined the Navy Reserves, retiring as a Navy captain in 1983. After serving as CACI's president and chief executive officer for 23 years, which employs over 20,000 individuals, he knows a little something about transitioning. Dr. London stepped out of the CEO role to become executive chairman in 2007. He has written and published two books, Our Good Name in 2008 and Character, The Ultimate Success Factor in 2013. And I've asked him to please present part of his book in his remarks. Additionally, Dr. London has earned numerous awards and recognition for leadership and service, including Alumni of the Year from GW in the School of Government and Business Administration. The Human Resources Leadership Award of the Greater Washington has established its Ethic and Business Award in Dr. London's name. He has been inducted into the Washington Business Hall of Fame, the Arlington, Virginia Chamber of Commerce Business Hall of Fame, and the Greater Washington Government Contractors Hall of Fame. All lifetime achievement awards honoring his positive impact on business and civic life in the communities in which he has lived and served. Next is Heather Vanner. She was commissioned as a U.S. Army officer after she completed her ROTC training at the Carnegie Mellon University. She went on to serve as a military intelligence officer with the 4th Brigade Command Combat Team, 10th Mountain Division, as a platoon officer for 2 years, whereupon she received a medical honorable discharge. Through her transitioning period, she met her husband, also a veteran, and they developed together a deep passion for volunteering in support of veteran transitioning and disabled veterans. She leveraged her military leadership experience, which she will talk about today, to build a career at Northrop Grumman from early 2010 to the present. She has served in a number of leadership roles at Northrop Grumman, including program manager, staffing manager, and operations manager. She currently serves as division programs manager for the Cyber and Intelligence Mission Solutions in division in Fairfax, Virginia. She is supporting a diverse portfolio of programs in the defense and government service sector. How we are going to do the panel today is each panel member will come up and speak at the podium. They will each have 9 minutes. When you see me give the sign, they know they have 2 minutes left. And after that, we're cutting it to 9 minutes per person, so that we'll allow each of you in the audience to have the opportunity to ask questions for 10 minutes. And hopefully as they're talking, and you have your pens in hand, I see, if you have any questions you really come to mind, write them down. Again, we welcome you all here today, and we're gonna start with Captain Lieutenant Colonel, but pilot captain.
Mr. Callen.
Airline pilot, huh? Why is he here? You are, at some point, some of you want to go into commercial aviation of some sort, and I'm here to speak to that. Some of the things that we need to impart on you knowledge-wise is our opinion of leadership and why it's important. Leadership is important in any sector of the society that you choose to go into, and you're taught a lot of it in the academies and in your training. I'd like to address a little bit towards leadership. It's funny, when I was asked to be on this panel, I started doing a little bit of research for this occasion, and I realized that I had been applying some of these traits, but I hadn't read about them in a long time. So if you'll excuse me looking down, I haven't got it memorized. But there are folks who are born leaders, but even if you're not predisposed genetically to become a leader, it can be learned. However, it's not easy. I go to the Marine Corps Officer's Manual and looked up the 14 traits of leadership that the Marine Corps looks for, and they are as relevant in the civilian society as they are in the military. The 14 traits are justice, judgment, dependability, initiative, decisiveness, tact, integrity, enthusiasm, bearing, unselfishness, courage, knowledge, loyalty, and endurance. Long list. I'm not going to go through each one of those, but I picked a couple at random to talk about. Every one of those traits are important, but I will start with the first one, justice. Justice is defined as the practice of being fair and consistent. A just person gives consideration to each side of a situation and bases rewards or punishments on merit. Be honest with yourself about why you make a particular decision as a leader and avoid favoritism, and try to be fair at all times and treat all matters and people in an equal manner. That's very important as a leader. Judgment is your ability to think about things clearly, calmly, and in an orderly fashion so that you can make good decisions. You can improve your ability to use good judgment if you avoid making rash decisions and always approach problems with a common sense attitude. I'll skip to integrity is a trait that cannot be overemphasized. If your word is as good as your character, you can be counted on, and integrity is the basis for everybody's respect for you. Speaking of respect, unselfishness is a very important trait. Never at the expense of others, make yourself more comfortable. Give credit to those that deserve it, and don't use your position or rank for personal gain. Never, ever expect someone to do a task that you would not tackle yourself. Lead by example. If there is an unsavory task that must be done, you should be the first in line, showing your leadership. If there's an event that's desirable, you should be the last in line. Always take care of your people first. And that leads me to the last one, loyalty. Loyalty is devotion to your God, your family, your country, and to your seniors, peers, and subordinates. In the Marine Corps, our motto is Semper Fidelis, always faithful. A great leader has unwavering loyalty to everyone up and down the chain of command. Show your loyalty by never discussing the problems of your company or group with outsiders. Never talk about seniors unfavorably in front of your subordinates, and never verbally discipline a subordinate in the presence of others. You've probably all heard this, but I'm going to repeat it anyway. Praise in public, criticize in private. Now, you've I'm sure most of you heard most of that stuff before, but just a nice refresher. Those of you wanting to go through your military career and transition to commercial flying, a couple of the things you need to keep in mind is volunteerism is important to being hired. Having a current resume, if you get out of the military and you stop flying, you need to find a way to keep yourself current. And if you really want the airline job, you've got to consistently reapply. They don't take everybody on their first try. I applied twice myself, and then there was a huge hiring event going on. I still had to apply a second time and change my resume just a little bit, and that got me in the door, and then I did the rest myself. But for you, always update your resume. Always keep current, make yourself relevant, and every company that I know of these days finds volunteerism important on your resume. It's not something you're going to hear much, but you can take it to the bank. That's all I have to say for now. Hope you enjoy your stay here. For those of you, I can see that some of you got up kind of early. Hope you make it through the day. Thank you very much.
Next will be Lieutenant Colonel John Flynn. And thank you, Paul, for saving 2 minutes.
Thanks, Barry. Good morning, everybody. How's everyone doing? Good to see everybody. You guys were here at 8 o'clock on time. That's great. I see the people with the wreaths. Now, you guys still do general knowledge tests? They still have that at the academies. They still have that in ROTC and that, right? All right. This is not testable, not attributable, so don't even worry about it. But before I get into this, one thing as we're talking about the afterlife of the military is people are probably telling you, you went to an academy, you went to ROTC, you went to OTS, you're golden, right? You're golden. There's going to be plenty of opportunities for you when you get out. That is true. That is true. But it doesn't mean that you stop your professional development. You have to keep your professional development going. So you can get your bachelor's degree, continue with your master's, get your MBA, some sort of master's, and continue that growth and continuous improvement, okay? So leadership. Man, that's a real, real nebulous term, right? Everyone talks about leadership. What exactly does that mean? I got to sit on a lot of panels to interview several of you, maybe not in this room, but to get into ROTC and to get into service academies. Got to vet a lot of folks at the White House, got to vet a lot of folks up on Capitol Hill as well. And so you've already been identified by national leaders, by your local leaders, by your high schools, that you are leaders. You already have those innate leadership traits, okay? So I'm not worried about that. Those are being ingrained in you. They're, in some cases, whether you like it or not, they're being ingrained in you right now. And that's going to serve you well going out, and especially when you get out into the corporate world, into whatever sector you go into, you'll reflect back on it and say, that's what they were trying to teach me. I get it now. But when you think about leadership, I think of it as it is the manifestation of your truest North Star internally. It's your values, it's your ethics, and it's your morals. And how you represent that to your soldiers, sailors, airmen, Marines, and Coast Guardsmen going out there, setting that right example, doing what you say you're going to do, following through on commitments, that's the overall scope of leadership from my vantage point. Different ways you can do that. I think some things that are important, especially as if you're a cadet commander, flight commander, and by the way, just because you're a commander doesn't mean you're a leader, right? And just because you're not a commander doesn't mean you can't be a leader. So remember that piece. But when you're setting that leadership tone for your squadrons and platoons, make sure that they know what that North Star is. Not necessarily your internal North Star, but what that overall goal, that mission that you're trying to achieve with your unit and for the overall Department of Defense. Make sure that's clear. Make sure that they also understand what their roles and responsibilities are to be able to achieve each of those missions along the way, and also reinforce those behaviors that they will need to go out and emulate and command and lead and follow to be able to achieve those missions. The next part about that is to ensure that that North Star, that mission is properly communicated, okay? And in order to properly communicate, that's where the trust has to be established. That's where you have to really get to know your people. You have to get to know what those internal motivations are, those drivers, okay? And as you get out and as you're serving, you're gonna be serving alongside civilians. So this isn't something that you're gonna be doing 10, 15, this is tomorrow. Your GS employees, defense contractors, you're gonna be serving alongside foreign nationals, State Department. Okay, so this isn't something that you can shelf on the back burner. You're gonna be doing this tomorrow, you're gonna be doing this in a couple of years. So getting to know those folks, knowing how to inspire, knowing how to motivate, hearing their story, like we talk about at MGM, hearing that story, and then that's where those connections, there's a scientific connection that happens, both chemically and neurologically, that inspires that trust, confidence, and then that loyalty in you as a commander. Now, kind of taking a step back, how do you do that? Like, how can you make those good decisions? How do you keep that energy going? How can you put on that smiling face so that when you're leading your soldiers, you're leading your personnel, what are some tricks of the trade? From if you read about it, and I've got to serve alongside of a CEO and chairman of the board, gotten to see some high-level officials do this as well. Three things, all right? I like to keep things in threes, right? Anything more than three, and I start forgetting it. First one is spiritual strength. Second one is physical strength. The third one is social strength, okay? Now, I don't mean the best Facebook account, right? I don't mean the best Instagram account. I'll talk about social here in just a second. But start off with the spiritual piece. The spiritual piece could be through prayer, it could be through meditation, but you're gonna have so much competing for your time and energy that it's gonna be hard to focus on what the true priorities are and what your decisions should be. So you have to be able to designate that quiet time, and I do it right when I wake up, before I look at my phone, before I turn on the TV, designate that quiet time for about 10 minutes to connect. And what that does, what I've been told it does, and hopefully I'm trying to emulate that as well in my personal life with my family and at work, is it starts to build up that internal intuition, that gut feeling, okay? And that gut feeling, and you've heard that term, the EQ, the emotional intelligence, that is so important, ladies and gentlemen. That is so important because you're gonna be required to make decisions that you don't have all the data. You're gonna have maybe 60% of the facts. It happens, you guys are facing that right now, okay? So you have to be able to trust that internal gut feeling of yours, and this will help strengthen that. So that's one. Two, the physical component. Obviously, gotta work out. Eat healthy, do all those sorts of things that we do, and I know that you guys are doing on a daily basis. Get a good night's sleep. When you sleep, what happens? That's when your brain gets refreshed. Literally, the spinal fluid goes up, refreshes your brain. That's why you wake up feeling so refreshed. Unless it's finals week, right? You come on, finals week, 2 hours, three cups of coffee, like that ain't happening, right? That's not gonna happen. But generally speaking, set up those processes with the spiritual piece, physical piece. Everyone saw Admiral McRaven's speech a couple years ago about making your bed, right? That's that internal process that you have to set up, those internal checklists, okay? So the physical piece is very, very important. By the way, mark my words, you saw Eleanor up here, 95 years old. I flew on the same planes that she built, okay? 95 years old, you're gonna live to be 120, 130, guarantee it. 120, 130, take care of yourselves now so that you can do that, and then we'll have to talk about retirement reform with the Department of Defense, because if we're living 120, 130, I don't know if that's gonna, you know. So that's number two. I got 2 minutes left, so 2 minute warning, no timeouts. The third piece is the social mechanism. Having that social support around you, that group of five or six people that you can trust and depend on, that group of four or five people that have that positive energy, that positive mental attitude, because you are gonna have competing interests. There's a lot of negativity out there, and you see it every day. So what do you want, who do you wanna be? Do you wanna surround yourself with the negative energy or the positive energy? And within that positive energy realm, okay, make sure you've got somebody in there that could tell you, that could be honest with you and tell you when you're messing up. You have to have that. Especially as you start coming up the ranks, people are gonna nod their heads and say, yes, sir, yes, ma'am, and kind of go with the flow. They're not gonna feel empowered to speak up to you. Make sure you have that friend. Make sure you have that colleague. Make sure you have somebody in that unit with you that will tell you when you need to course correct. Okay? So you pull all that together. And one last thing on the social piece. We've talked about volunteerism up here. Okay? The volunteerism and giving back. Everybody in here is already a public servant. Okay? I can't stress that enough. And what that does as you inspire confidence in your troops and your soldiers and your airmen is going out and serving, going out into the communities, being a part of something greater than yourself, right? That's what we're in here. We're all the same mission, something greater than ourselves. But most people don't have much experience with the military. Most people, their first experience is maybe seeing us on TV, seeing us in response to a crisis. But getting out there, being present, volunteering, standing up for those things that you want to represent, that will bring it back into that social thing, that will bring it back into the physical aspect, and that will also help you in the spiritual piece, right? So spiritual, physical, social. Thank you.
Next, I'd like to ask Dr. Jack London to speak.
Thank you, Barry. And I got to say good morning and what a delight and pleasure it is to be here. I've had the opportunity to participate on and off for several years, and it's always great to be back here. We have a wonderful group of folks here today that are very interested in what the future holds for them individually and specifically. And I've got a few thoughts I'll share with you. First of all, let me just say it's been over 40 years, I'm not going to give the exact number, but over 40 years since I was leaving the service and looking into the civilian world. I did that too. A little Freudian slip there, but that's okay. I just want to say that the change that you'll go through is one that many, many people have been through. So there's lots of precedents and experience and some of the things we're going to share with you this morning. Over at CCI, a little organization that I'm involved with and been involved with over 47 years, we have a very active military veterans recruiting and bringing onboarding process. It's run by a retired Major General, United States Army, combat veteran of both Afghanistan and Iraq, a West Point graduate, and he does a wonderful job for me. How wonderful does he do? I've got 20,000 employees in my organization, 20,000, about 6,000, 7,000 here in the local area, the rest around the planet, and 37% of my employee base are veterans. Now, it does include old-timers like me, but we have a big, significant group of the younger group of folks in the veteran community. 9% of that group are disabled veterans. 9% of my 20,000 people are disabled. You say, my Lord, Jack, we work at it. It's not something that happens by accident. It's a whole programmatic objective that I have and have had for many years, bringing in people that are serving in the reserve, which I did while I was at with CACI in my early days. And I've had this focus on veteran participation, and I think we're pretty well known for it. President Obama had me over at the White House along with the other executives on two different occasions in the last 4 or 5 years of his tenure, giving recognition to those corporations in America that had led the activity associated with recruiting veterans. And I'm very proud of that. And that's something that I'd like to ask you to reflect on a little bit as you think about your future as well. I do have a book that I published a few years ago, Character, The Ultimate Success Factor, forwarded by Norman Augustine, the great creator of Lockheed Martin many years ago and a terrific friend of mine. On the back of it, I got a guy named Roger Staubach, a friend of mine, that signed an endorsement. Some of you folks in the Army world may know Roger the Dodger from a little different perspective, but he did endorse my book. I've got Colonel Lee Ellis, United States Air Force retired, former Vietnam POW that endorsed my book, 5.5 years incarcerated. And then my wonderful friend, Commander Everett Alvarez, 8.5 years incarcerated in Vietnam as a POW. And he was the longest incarcerated of all wonderful friends of mine. So guys that endorse this book, what you got here, and I heartily recommend it to you because it was written for you. Written for you. There is a formula in here for your career development. It's a good reflection on career and character and the concepts of integrity and leadership. But in particular, younger folks that are looking forward through their career, I think you'll get a notion of a roadmap. I'm giving this book to anybody who wants it here. My assistant will have a card that you can send an email and request if you want it. It's up to you, but it's free. I was asked to talk a little bit about the definition of leadership, and that's always a good one. I certainly agree with my colleagues already who have expressed perspectives on what leadership is all about, and I agree with everything they said. I probably would add just a little quotation from a guy named Admiral Arleigh Burke. Admiral Arleigh Burke. He was the CNO of the United States Navy a number of years ago, a great leader, a great wartime, World War II. He was known as Admiral 31 Knot Burke because of his inclinations to race out in front and engage the enemy. Had a wonderful career. So I asked him what is leadership, and here's what he said. Understanding people and involving them to help you do a great job. It takes all of the good characteristics like integrity, dedication of purpose, selflessness, knowledge, skill, implacability, as well as determination not to accept failure. And I would just modify that, but say always to make sure we're successful. I met Arleigh Burke once upon a time. Had an opportunity just to visit with him shortly. I also met another fellow by the name of Omar Bradley, 5-star general of the United States Army. And I have a quote in my book. By the way, my book is loaded with quotes. I had a lot of fun pulling them together. Leadership is intangible, and therefore no weapon ever designed can replace it, because it's a people thing. Leadership belongs to people. So there's only one a little additive that I would put on top of the comments about leadership, and it has to do with creating direction, commitment to direction. That's a big piece of leadership. And all the other aspects of character and integrity are also very important. But if you aren't out there with vision and leadership and can inspire people as to how to accomplish things, you're not going to be a very successful leader, bottom line, at least from my perspective. There are 4 intangibles associated with leadership that I'll pass on. They're out of my book as well. Integrity, courage and conviction, commitment, and vision and direction. And I've talked to that a little bit. I want to sort of seal some ideas, plant some ideas about what really leadership is all about. So in terms of where you are, maybe we can talk a little bit about your position and where you can take yourselves. For example, let's start with mission focus. In the military, maximum national security for the American people is objective. That's what the military's mission is all about. Well, in the private sector, interestingly, in an analogous fashion, you're interested in securing the future and maximizing results for your stakeholders in the private sector and community, for your customers and your employees. So how successful are you going to be in achieving your mission depends on similar factors, a culture of good character, leaders who understand how to prioritize and set objectives. You learn that in the military. You learn it almost every day. The key is finding corporate cultures that align with your values and your goals. So we've talked a little bit about culture. I also want to talk about accountability. This is the whole idea of being responsible and taking accountability for what you do and how you say it and how you implement your plans and how you behave in your leadership role. Teamwork, incredibly important. When I recruit people, there are four things I look at. Four things, only four. Attitude, integrity, commitment, and expertise. You say, my Lord, why is expertise last? Well, I got a reason. If attitude isn't there, if you can't play as a team player and participate and contribute, I don't want you on my team. I don't give a damn how smart you are. And I want you to have integrity. I want to be able to trust you and understand and believe what you tell me that you'll get done. Third is commitment. I want you on board. I don't want lip service. I want involvement. I want your best ideas, your best thinking. I want your commitment to what we're trying to achieve in the mission. And lastly is expertise. You say, my God, Jack, last is expertise. And I tell you why. If your attitude isn't good, and if you're not supportive and a participating player, if I can't trust you, if I don't know you're on the team, your good expertise can, and many times, just foul up the system. So think about that as you go out and look at your opportunities. The final thoughts I would have in terms of looking for career opportunities, do your own investigative work. Look at the organizations that you might be interested in becoming a member of. Do a little vetting, for God's sake. Look at their background, their reputation. What do they amount to? What's their culture like? Do you want to be affiliated with that organization or not? Make sure you have a good feel for who they are and what they're offering you. And take a deep look and do some reference checking. So those are some concepts. I hope there's some takeaways for you, in particular the idea of what your attitude is as you go out and look for your opportunities. And the other thing is do that vesting. It's really important. So thank you for the opportunity to visit with a little bit about it. And the book's free. So.
My name isn't on the back, but I'll endorse the book as well. I just want to comment that each of the, before I introduce Heather, that they represent American Airlines, MGM Resorts International, Northrop Grumman, and CACI. All four corporations are large corporations, all support our men and women in the Army, the Navy, the Marine Corps, the Air Force, Coast Guard. They are all committed to helping veterans. And I'll next introduce Heather Banner, who is a good example of being hired as a veteran at Northrop Grumman.
Wow, those are some tough acts to follow. I bring a slightly different perspective to the idea of a successful transition, but I think you'll find a number of the things I say will be quite familiar from what you just heard. I had planned to serve 20 years. Growing up, my mentors and coaches were veterans. It was never a question about would I serve, but where would I serve? Marines, Army, I didn't think Air Force, but I want it for my kids now. I had planned for 20 years. I only got to do two. So when I transitioned, I did not bring a resume of strong, long experience with me. But I did bring a couple of things. I brought resilience. The transition was hard. At times, I felt like a failure. You guys are the elite of the elite. You are part of a very few people who will be privileged to serve in our armed services. And you are probably not used to feeling like a failure. But going through that, I was able to leverage the experience that I had built through ROTC and through my service, that resilience I had developed through activity after activity, to pick myself up and move on and find out that you can go on to bigger and more successful things. And yes, you can still serve in cuter shoes even after you are no longer in the service. I want to pause and look at ethics and what it means within corporate America. We don't hear a lot about ethics and value and integrity in the media, and we don't hear about it a lot as something that you have to develop if you want to go get that MBA, but it is critically important. As a manager, when I evaluate my employees' performance, I look at two things. One, how well did they perform against their stated objectives? And two, how did they perform it? Did they perform it showing the values that we have clearly documented that everybody in our company knows we need to live by? Or did they achieve those high results by running over their teammates? If you have the highest numbers, but you do not live our values, you will not have a successful performance rating. You will not get the promotion. You will not get the great opportunities. You will not get the pay increase. Values are critical. Why? In government contracting, unethical behavior costs millions, literally. Somebody fudging their time card can result in money being paid back to the government, as it should be. But it'll also cost legal fees. It can cost performance issues, and it costs time to deal with ethical issues when we could be dealing with mission and supporting mission. So that is why ethics is very important. And you might say that's government contracting, but I'm going to be an entrepreneur. I don't want to stick around and keep sitting in the same government buildings. I want to try something new. I have great ideas. I'm going to implement it. Great. Venture capitalists, when they are looking for new companies to invest in, before they even look at a business plan, they look at the ethics of the leadership of the company. They look at the integrity of the company and how they do business. It does not matter how good your business plan is. If you cannot represent that you will do business with integrity and strong character, you will not get the money, you will not grow. So as a PM, when I look at which companies I want to include on my programs, who I want to give business to, I also look at how they perform business, whether they're ethical, and whether they are somebody who is going to partner us with us in a way that shows our values. So it is critically important throughout your career, wherever you serve. I had some help in my transition, and it helped me be where I am today. I love to spend all my free time, as much of it as I have, passing that on. So some of the things I'd like to share with you are things that I've told a lot of veterans transitioning one-on-one. I'd like to tell them to you a little bit earlier. When it comes to your service, volunteer. You probably won't hear that a lot when you're on active duty. It's not a word people like to throw around. But being willing to raise your hand and step outside of your comfort zone will get you opportunities. It will help you build a broad foundation, even if you only have a short time to do it in. I did a lot of TDYs. I was able to use those experiences, as short as they were, as a base for when I did business, because it gave me a broad exposure to different types of programs and projects. Also, going on a TDY, going to a strange location, showing up and finding out that you are suddenly the subject matter expert on something you have never done before, being able to then execute successfully will give you the confidence to continue to go into situations where you are not comfortable and to execute successfully and to make a difference. So volunteer wherever you have an opportunity and you think you can bring value. Don't be afraid to raise your hand. When it comes to looking at the logistics of how to transition, there's a couple things I always recommend. Take a minute and pause and think about what you really want to do. So many veterans I talk to are just looking for a job. You will find a job. You are fabulous, but you may not be happy in it. Do the research. Find a company that aligns with your values. Coming out of service, you may not be happy with a company where most of the management team does long lunches and golf outings. It may not be a good fit for you. Look at what you want out of your future. Talk with your family, and then find a great opportunity. When you found the great opportunity, you're going to need to take that fresh resume, and you are going to need to tailor it specifically for that opportunity. Many of the recruiters and hiring managers will not have your background, and they will not inherently understand the excellent qualities you can bring to their work. You need to look at the requisition and what they are asking for, and you need to make it very clear where you believe you can meet or exceed those expectations. You need to be resilient. You will be rejected. And if you reapply, you will probably be accepted. But it takes time sometimes. So try to give yourself that time and plan in advance. You may have a perfect job that you have identified, and you may be missing experience. You may not have hired people before or managed a large budget, depending on what your assignments look like. Through volunteering, as we've already mentioned, you can sometimes gain that experience. Nonprofits and community organizations are always looking for people to be on their boards, and that is a great way to flesh out your resume. Leverage the assistance available to you. We don't always like to ask for help. It makes us feel weak. It makes us feel like a failure. But there are so many people out there who are going to want you to be very, very successful. Don't be afraid to ask for help. Don't be afraid to use the help. We know that once you have found your feet, you will pay it forward and help the next generation of veterans coming behind you. We were helped in our time, and now is our time to help you. So as I wrap up, I'd like to leave you with one quote. I don't know who said it. I heard it from a friend at work, probably a veteran. And it is, serve your mission, serve your people. Look for opportunities to give up your power to improve the integrity and the quality of your organization. Thank you for your time.
We're now going to begin our 10-minute question and answer period. If you have a question, please raise your hand when you stand up. I'd like you to state your name and your school or your service if you're on active duty, or you're, if you're a veteran, you're...
We're not going to have 10 minutes.
Okay.
I'm sorry.
Okay. Well, when we're cut off at that point, we'll get as many questions in as we can. And if you have a question directly for a specific person, please state. Can I open it up for questions? Yes, please.
Want to pivot to what she was talking about earlier about finding the right company with the right culture. That's one thing that I did. I got exposed to several different companies that were out there. And in Las Vegas, Nevada, we have one of the most diversified workforces in the country. And so without getting too far down the road, you have to make sure as the leader of the organization, and it starts at the top with our chairman and CEO, our diversity and inclusion initiatives are number one for him. Doesn't matter your background, doesn't matter where you came from, doesn't matter any of your core beliefs, doesn't matter. He wants, and the board wants, who's gonna do the best job. Now, we've started this servant leadership philosophy. And the servant leadership philosophy is basically empowering your people, getting to know them like I was talking about earlier, but also highlighting dignity and respect for everybody, okay? You guys were at, didn't you guys see the Constitution last night, from what I understand, right? Okay, and also just in terms of historic documents, there are certain inalienable rights, okay? When you were born as an American, everybody has those rights. So it is important that, like I said, it starts at the top, that it resonates and reverberates throughout the rest of the organization. And then for us, our employees, our 81,000 employees, when they're out there serving the guests and serving the customer, they know we've got their backs, no matter what. And that's gonna result in better guest service, loyalty from our customers. You're gonna bring your family back, you're gonna bring your kids back.
Thank you. I was told we have time for one more question. Who has that final question? It's hard to see with the light. Is there any other?
Over here.
Yes.
Anthony Wong from the Virginia Military Institute, this dinner. My question is for you. And with the rapid development of very powerful technologies, things like artificial intelligence, how are you able to keep your ethic, balance your ethics with being able to do your job correctly with the scary cyber world now?
So I love that question. I'm actually going back to schools to increase my skills in machine learning and artificial intelligence. It is a challenge, but I think it goes back to having a clear understanding of who you are as a leader and who you are as an organization. Our current CEO, Wes Bush, is a man of very strong character. And we have a lot of town halls and people would ask, why are we not pursuing this program or getting involved in this initiative? And he would come back and go, that's not the direction we want to go as a company. That may be good money, but that program gets involved in things that we as a company don't feel align with our values. I think that when it comes to the ethics around artificial intelligence, that is something that we are going to see continuing to evolve over the next several years. I don't think anyone has a clear answer as to what good ethics looks like with artificial intelligence. It's kind of at that stage of, you know, I can't define it, but I know it's wrong when I see it. And that's where a lot of the companies are feeling it out. We have a need to protect our country, to ensure that we are never in a fair fight, but we want to make sure we're doing it the right way for our citizens. Does that answer your question?
I'd like to add one point on that. The real challenge is not an AI, it's an automation. It's delegation of lethal decisions to machine algorithms. That's the ethical paradigm or paradox that we've got to address, and soon.
Thank you. I want to thank our panel. It's been very interesting for all of you. And I want to thank all of you for being so attentive and wish all of you luck in continuing your studies and in your careers in the military.